Need some energy? Need to quench your thirst? Try Pitbull Sugar-Free Energy Drink, the only energy drink named suitable for diabetics by the American Diabetic Association. And it's now available with no calories, no carbs, no sugar, and no fat, and a smooth, natural blend of energy, vitamins, and minerals. Need to quench your thirst? Try Pitbull Sugar-Free Energy Drink, the only energy drink named suitable for diabetics by the American Diabetic Association. And it's now available with no calories, no carbs, no sugar, and no fat, and a smooth, natural blend of energy, vitamins, and minerals. Pitbull Sugar-Free Energy Drink is the healthiest, best-tasting energy drink around. For more information and online ordering with free shipping, please visit hiphopbev.com. Remember, Pitbull Sugar-Free Energy Drink, suitable for diabetics, great for everyone.
Hey, okay, whoops. Hey, da-da-da. Whoa, I forgot. All right, so you guys still here? All right, so continuing on, Steve, so go ahead and tell us more.
Okay, so we've been talking about making sure your chips are registered. So for appreciation of having us on, we're actually going to let your viewers and listeners get a discount registration in PETLINK if they want to register their chip with us.
Oh.
So if they go to PETLINK.net and go to register a microchip, when they get to the checkout page, they just put in FAW for Foster's Animal World, and it will reduce the registration from $19.99 down to $9.99, and that will be a lifetime registration. They'll never have to pay another dime for the upkeep and updating of that microchip registration.
Really?
They'll have all the benefits of PETLINK. Yeah.
Oh, wait. Wow. That's incredible. So, all right. So you got to say that again, because Rock was telling me something was going on with the board and the engineer and phones and all this stuff. So that we got to get to. But say that again. They go to PETLINK this lifetime. And you guys, listeners and everyone, you know, that's not seeing this live. If you're seeing this live, you're hearing some great news that that actually affects the bottom line dollar. Oh, look at that. You know, there you go. And so this is a lifetime registration, which is huge, you know. I mean, because in my household, every dime counts, you know, especially when you buying dog food. Right, Richard?
That's right. It sure does.
You know, so this is a promo code. So they don't. OK, so tell us, Steve, how this works again.
They go to PETLINK.net. And
okay.
Make sure it's PETLINK.net. There is a company, unfortunately, that uses PETLINK.com and kind of hijacks our registrations. But PETLINK.net, they'll go to the website and select to register a microchip. They'll put in the microchip number, and it will double check to make sure that microchip not already registered.
Mm-hmm.
And then they'll just continue through the registration process, which is entering their personal information, the name, phone number, address, again, email. It's great if they enter a cell phone number so they can get a found pet notification by text.
Mm-hmm.
I'll show you that in a second. And then they'll enter their pet information, so the pet name, the breed, any special markings, any medication concerns. If that pet were to show up found at a shelter, they would be able to know that that pet needs some special attention.
Mm-hmm. So
and put all that in. And when they go to the checkout page, if they put in FAW, it will again knock the registration from $19.99 down to only $9.99.
Oh, so here we go. I go to the vet and tell him I want the PETLINK chip in my dog, right? Is that correct?
Correct.
Okay, that's what I. I'm just getting this.
So, they may or may not be using us, and so I mean, if you want to insist on a PETLINK, we're insisting. Let you know of a local vet.
We're insisting because we're always open for sponsors, Steve. But right now, I mean, you're a friend of the show, regardless, and we appreciate the discount for our listeners and Foster's Animal World family. So you know, right now, you guys are it. So you know, we want to, and plus Richard, see, I mean, I'm the guy that tries to get the spotlight to turn on to the problems, because we're here in Hollywood and we're trying to use Hollywood as we believe in education through entertainment, you know? People like Richard, who's part of the family, he's in the trenches. Richard is living the dog rescue world every day of his life. You know, I depend on people like him to guide me. We're all old enough to remember Muhammad Ali. And Ali had something that I live by, man. He said, you know, I don't have to be the smartest man in the world. I just surround myself with him, you know. So that's what I try to do, is to surround myself with the people who really know. And so you guys, if Richard says this is the best product out there, that's the one that we're supporting. So we will ask our people to ask for your product. And now this discount, that's forever, right? Because our show gets archived, and this is going to be pumped and pumped and pumped for now on, you know? And all the little engagements and stuff that I do, I'll be pumping that up. So that won't go away in like 2 weeks or nothing, right?
Oh, nope, we'll leave it available, for forever. So it's good. The video lasts on YouTube, or you want to promote it, absolutely. It's good.
Yeah, we'll pump it up. Right, Paula? Uh-oh.
You bet.
Okay, Paula, when I'm talking, she's feeding dogs and squirrels and all kinds of stuff. You know, you do that when you got that acreage. I'm sorry, Rock, who we have on the phone? Hey. Somebody from Iowa? The Humane Society from Iowa. Okay, they caught me, guys. Hold on a second. All right, hello?
Hello yourself.
Hi, how are you?
I'm sitting out here in my yard with my dogs. So
oh, okay.
I'm good.
Okay, good. Then you guys aren't outside my door with handcuffs. That's cool, then. Let's talk.
We could arrange that.
Yeah, I can never tell. You know, I always have to check. You know, so what's your name?
My name is Abby, A-B-B-Y Benefield.
Hey, Abby. So how can we do you today?
Well, you know, I've been listening as best I can. It's not streaming so well on my phone, but we switched to PETLINK chips about 2 years ago.
Okay.
And I guess, if anything, maybe this is an endorsement. One of the reasons, and there are several, but one of the reasons we switched is... The company we were using before was hassling our clients unbearably. We would register the chips with this other company, and then their emails would blow up wanting them to buy other products from this company.
Mm.
And that's just not cool.
That's not cool whatsoever. So they were flipping.
And we found out that this other company isn't even American based. They're outside of the U.S.
Uh-oh. Which, get a rope.
Yeah, I know. But anyway, so the other reason that we switched is these chips are so much incredibly smaller that they are more easy to insert, and there's less trauma to the pet. You know, if you're trying to microchip a 2-pound kitten, you don't want a chip the size of a golf ball.
Oh, good point. Good point. That's right. I hadn't thought about that, because most of my dogs are big.
Yeah.
I
have a 4-pound Yorkie that is wearing a PETLINK chip, and I waited to chip her until we got on board with PETLINK, because I wanted her to have the smallest possible chip.
Right. That makes sense.
Do it anyway. But let me tell you about my rep.
Okay.
And what they've done for us. Her name is Gabby Evans.
Okay, is this the same rep? This is Richard's rep, right?
She's my rep also.
Oh, well, we gotta get Gabby on here, because Gabby's got good vibes going on around the country here. Okay, go right ahead, please.
Anyway, about 5 months ago, I went out of state to pick up a couple of dogs from a breeding facility. Several breeding facilities release dogs to us from time to time. And this poor dog, upon x-ray, we found that she had 4 different microchips.
Oh, wow.
We were able to isolate them and record the numbers, but I couldn't track down one of the numbers. It would not come up in any of the files that I have to backtrack on you know, which company manufactured which chip.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Now, keep in mind that microchips have a specific pattern of numbers, and so the pattern helps you determine which company made those chips. Okay, if that makes sense to you. Like,
yeah.
If it starts with 00A, it's one company, and if it starts with, you know, something else, it's a different company.
Right.
But this particular chip did not come back to any company that I could identify. And so I called the amazing, astounding Gabby Evans, and she and her crew managed to track down this chip for me. And as it turned out, it was a European chip. So, you know,
so
they
the dog
went
had
way
been
above and beyond what was
kidnapped.
What, you know,
the dog had been like dog napped and what
no,
do you call it?
You know,
slave traded.
The chip actually came into the United States through a very questionable source, shall we say?
Justin Bieber?
Well, anyway, but, you know, the whole point here is that they don't just help us backtrack on registrations for their chips. They help us find the registrations for chips that they haven't even manufactured, that aren't
right.
even their responsibility.
Wow. Yeah, that's integrity.
And
that's the word.
Twice. They've helped us with that twice.
Yeah, you don't find people with that kind of, you know, integrity, man. You know?
Well, dedication, you
yeah.
know.
Yeah.
For them, it's not just about their product. It's about the animal that's wearing a product, whether it's theirs or someone else's. And if they can help, they'd go above and beyond to help us. So.
We need to see if this Gabby lady needs another job.
Cause
no, you know,
Paula.
We like Gabby.
Hey,
our Gabby for
hey Paula,
no,
you know what I'm
no,
saying?
I'm out to California with my gun, Foster. No. You leave Gabby where she's at.
Yeah.
She's my rock. She helps me so much.
Said,
yep.
Things
yep.
that make you yep. go, Paula, you know?
That's right.
That sounds like a team player there, boy.
Yeah. Well, and then, you know, sorry about the barking dog.
That's all right.
The other thing is, you know, the cost effectiveness of this, while there are cheaper chips, there are not better chips. They, you know, each chip comes with an individual insertion tool so that you don't run the risk of picking up an insertion appliance and then there's no needle in it. You
wow.
use it once and you throw it away.
Wow, that's
and that is incredibly efficient, especially if you're doing microchip applications for the public and you have 100 people lined up for chips. You don't want to accidentally not chip a dog.
Yeah, right.
So, anyway.
Right.
Okay?
Well,
Abby, you brought up a good point. I just was going to expand on just a little bit. What Abby was talking about there, Foster, is for years, up until about 4 years ago, every chip that was sold in the U.S. had an assigned manufacturing code. So I mentioned earlier that if you scan a chip or a pet and it comes up 981, everybody in the animal health industry pretty much knows that's a PETLINK chip. If it comes up 985, that belongs to a different manufacturer. If it comes up and starts with 977, it's a different manufacturer. And you can identify the chip manufacturer those first three digits
mm-hmm.
of the 15-digit number. About 4 years ago, there were a number of companies, there's now six or seven, that started bringing in a chip that carries what's called a generic manufacturing code. It starts 900. If you get a pet and get 900, unfortunately, it doesn't point you to one specific manufacturer. There's a laundry list of people that could have supplied that chip.
Mm.
And what I was referring to, and I'm sure Richard maybe can comment on this as well, that too often, again, people don't register the chip or keep the chip registration current with a, when I can identify or when Richard can identify the supplier, the manufacturer of that chip, they will contact the supplier, find out who that chip was sold to, then contact that clinic or shelter to see if they have the pet owner information. And that's the length that these shelter workers and rescue groups will go to. I talked to one office in Virginia, and if she can't find the registration online, she goes to Facebook, she goes to Craigslist, and goes to all kinds of links to try and find, is anybody looking for this pet? Unfortunately, if someone just had registered the microchip, she wouldn't have to go to all those steps.
Exactly.
So, but being able to identify the manufacturer is important, and we started seeing a lot of calls from people like Drew and Abby saying, hey, I've got a dog here in my shelter, and it's got a 900 chip. I can't find any information about this. I called three shelters and a rescue group outside Chicago and asked them, how big of a problem is this? In the couple prior to my call, they had seen 20 pets come into their facilities that had chips that start with this 900 number. Unfortunately, they couldn't find registrations for any of those 20 dogs. They couldn't identify the supplier for any of those 20 chips. All 20 pets were adopted by new pet owners. So despite the fact that a veterinarian and a loving pet owner had done what they thought was a good thing and put a microchip into this pet, either the pet wasn't registered, but more importantly, they couldn't identify the manufacturer and get this pet back home. So there's been a lot of information about these 900 chips start to be populated. In fact, a great article has been done by the Lost Dogs of Wisconsin. And if you go to lostdogsofwisconsin.org, you can read a lot more information about this. Steve Dale, a reporter with the Chicago Tribune, did a great article.
We know Steve. Steve's a friend of the show.
So, yeah. Yep. So, yeah, he's a great guy. He did a wonderful article a couple of weeks ago about the fact that, unfortunately, there's microchip companies that aren't doing a job of helping really to get pets back home. I mean, we take that job seriously, and we'll do everything, as you've heard, we can to help get a pet out of the shelter or back to the pet owner.
Right.
Let me interject just a side note there. Iowa and Missouri are number one and number two in the number of commercial dog breeders, people who breed large numbers of dogs for the pet trade. And the majority of those commercial dog breeders are now using those 900 number chips because they can buy them cheaply. And they've done what's required of them by law, but there's no follow-up, there's no follow-through. And so we're seeing more and more of those 900 number dogs come through our shelter as well.
Yeah.
That's unfortunate.
The sad thing is, if we're 900 number, we can't trace back to people. We can't find the original owner. So either the dog gets euthanized eventually or gets adopted by somebody else. The family never gets their animal back. And that's the sad thing because, you know, we spend this money. We want our animals safe, but we don't know that, you know, there are great companies out there like PetLink that can do all this for you and do it cheaply or freely. Then you risk the chance of the dog being euthanized. And that's the one thing why we as Unchained Love back this company so well and love what they do, because I can call Gabby in the middle of the night and say, Gabby, we found this dog. We cannot find this chip. She's like, okay, give me 5 seconds to wake up, rub my eyes, drink some coffee, and we'll get on this. And she's always been there to help me and help my rescue save a dog's life. And there's not been a time, because of the awesome folks at PetLink, we haven't been able to find an owner. We had a dog that we found at a truck stop, which isn't very far from my house, that showed up microchipped from some vet in Florida off of a no-name brand. And eventually, Gabby and the wonderful crew at PetLink helped track the owners, who were three owners down from the original ones who chipped the dog, trace it to them, and we were able to get a number and finally find these people through them contacting everyone who did register, because the last family did not register the chip. We finally got a hold of them, found out what happened, met the people, got the dog back to them. I mean, it took us about a week, but the dog was safe, got home where it belonged. So,
well, and those are the best stories that offer validity to the fact that microchips save lives. There are other forms of identification, but there's no permanent form, and that's what PetLink does. They're here for the long haul.
Yes, they are.
Yeah.
All right.
Anyway.
All right, but I had people trying to contact me, but somehow I lost my internet connection. Rock. So maybe we need to take a commercial for a second, so I can try to.
Right, I need to get back out to the shelter. So
okay. Well, thank you so much for calling and sharing, you know, with us, because, you know, I can't trust Richard, you know. I mean, yeah, so definitely another endorsement helps co-sign him, you know. So, Paula, I think we have to keep him.
Thanks, Abby, for your coverage.
All right. You're welcome. Bye-bye.
Okay. We'll be right back after word from our sponsor. Thanks.
Are you a diabetic? Need some energy? Need to quench your thirst? Try Pitbull Sugar-Free Energy Drink, the only energy drink named suitable for diabetic by the American Diabetic Association. And it's now available with no calories, no carbs, no sugar, and no fat, and a smooth, natural blend of energy, vitamins, and minerals. Need to quench your thirst? Try Pitbull Sugar-Free Energy Drink, the only energy drink named suitable for diabetics by the American Diabetic Association. And it's now available with no calories, no carbs, no sugar, and no fat, and a smooth, natural blend of energy, vitamins, and minerals. Pitbull Sugar Free Energy is healthy. Philadelphia's best-tasting energy drink around. For more information and online ordering with free shipping, please visit hiphopbev.com. Remember, Pitbull sugar-free energy drink, suitable for diabetics, great for everyone.
All right. Hey, I got a little bit of information, too, for everyone out there listening. If you're watching live on a mobile device, don't click on the regular watch live. Click on the mobile app or Ustream. And Rock was just telling me that it streams a lot easier and better and faster on the mobile device app or Ustream. You know, if you're at home sitting on a computer, then you click on the regular live and everything. So anyway, and I was saying that for a lot of people in Chicago, I know watch us and as they can on mobile devices and other different stuff. And so that's a bit of information for you guys too. So anyway, continuing on, Steve, wait a minute before I do that. Paula Archer, are you there?
I'm here.
Am I passing, have I passed your time for your dogs? Because Steve is with us and I know he's probably got somewhere to be, but we want to get some dogs out of the shelters at the same time. So am I good to continue with Steve, or do you want to do some dogs right now?
I would like to do some dogs right now if Steve is able to stand by. If not, I can wait.
Steve, you got a minute?
Sure, absolutely. Let's rescue some dogs.
Sir, we truly appreciate it, you know, because all of us are going home tonight, and we'd like for one of these babies to go home somewhere, too, instead of spending the night in the shelter and worrying about getting that big needle or whatever they do around the country. They're still gassing and heart-sicking. And, hey, we did a heart-sick episode you need to see. Check out, Steve. It's on our YouTube page, you know? Heart-sick is a cold process. Okay, so Rock and Paula, you guys take away.
Ready, Rock?
Ready.
Yes.
Okay, we have... I'm ready. Here we go. We have Jezebel. She is a small pocket pity. She is a little timid in shelter, but she opens up once outside. She pretty much just wants to curl up on her bed in her kennel, and then she stares up at you with these sad eyes. Really breaks your heart. She really just wants someone to love. Now we have Tyson. This boy is a love fighter. He is a goofy, playful guy who loves any affection. The poor guy is starting to lose hope that his new family will find him. Because he came into the shelter already neutered, his adoption fee is only $25. Now we have Pace. Pace has a friendly demeanor. He wags his tail and licks my hand at the kennel door. Is quite a large boy, but is very, very sweet. He came in with a female pit bull, Millie. So we know he gets along with her, but the staff has not had the opportunity to test him with any other dogs. Now we have Oreo. Oreo is 4 years old. He's very sweet. He is a big boy who is quite strong, so he will need an experienced owner that can handle his strength. However, don't let that deter you because he is one fantastic dog. He is heartworm positive, but Friends of Rowlett Animals will sponsor his heartworm treatment through their vet. Now we have Cinder. Cinder is a gorgeous brindle boy, and he's estimated to be between a year to 2 years old. Cinder loves people but does not appear to like other dogs at the shelter. He is sweet and playful, though. He loves getting attention from the volunteers. Cinder is heartworm negative. Now we have one of my favorites, Cookie. Cookie is a very sweet girl who lost her way. Sadly, her family never came looking for her. She is very sweet, who wants to love a family. She is estimated to be about 3 years old, and she's a big girl. She weighs in around 70 pounds. Now we have Millie, and Millie is the one that came in with Pace. Millie is a very sweet and loving girl.
She is estimated to be about 4 years old. She came in with PACE, so we know she gets along with at least him. The staff hasn't had an opportunity to test her with any of the other animals. She loves people and wants nothing more than to be in your lap. The second photo of Millie, this is a tearjerker. Look at this sweet girl. I think she's saying, what do you mean? That's not how you get a close-up. She's very, very loving. Now we have Caviar. He is an adult male cane corso pit bull mix, probably around 3 years old. Caviar absolutely loves people, including kids. He is loving, affectionate, friendly, and playful. Caviar is a big boy at 72 pounds. While he loves all people, he is very choosy about his canine companions. So we recommend he go to a home with no other pets. Caviar is potty trained and crate trained. He also rides very well in a car. He is neutered, fully vaccinated, heartworm negative, and microchipped. His new home will require a tall fence. So that is Caviar. He's just a big, goofy, affectionate boy looking for his forever home. These animals are available for adoption or rescue from Rowlett Animal Shelter, Rowlett, Texas. Their phone number is 972-412-6219. And they are open Monday through Saturday, 10 to 5. Give them a call or stop by and make a new friend today. That's all I have for this set, Foster.
All right. Well, that was great. That guy's name is Caviar. You sure it wasn't Javier? I was like,
he's a cutie.
Yeah, she's pronouncing it like I would. So, hey, okay. So, for those of you who may just be tuning in, it's our 9 o'clock hour. We have on the Skype with us today, Steve, what's your last name?
Wilcox.
Wilcox, that's what I said. And I'm glad you didn't change it. Yeah, Steve Wilcox. And Steve's company is PETLINK.net, and they make microchips for your pet. You know, one of the most important items or things that go along with pet ownership to me, you know, right behind spayed and neutering your dog or cat, it is getting a chip in the dog or cat, you know, because responsible ownership is the name of the game, you know. So we're going to continue with Steve right now, and he's doing a presentation that's informing us of all the things that are wonderful about this product and the ins and outs about how to go to your veterinarian. And one of the most important things is Steve is, and his company has just given, if you use the Foster's Animal World FWA promo code, you will get a major discount, you know, off the registration of your dog for now on, for lifetime. Yes, that's correct, for life, okay? And you never have to do this again, or if you do it again, you get discounted. But, you know, you can, if you miss the other portion of the show, you just click the button, you know, this is YouTube, you know, on this, I'm talking for the archive version. Just go back and see section number one, because I'll probably bust this up into three different sections or something. So look and see and get that promo code and save some money and save your dog and save you from crying and whining and, you know, having to have your dog or cat on our show as a dog being getting ready to be put to sleep because somebody didn't, you know, have the responsibility of getting a chip put in it. So, Steve, continue on.
Okay, so one of the things I want to make sure, people always ask this question when talking about microchip, so is it a GPS?
Mm-hmm.
And absolutely not a a microchip is not a GPS device, so you can't open up an app and track your dog with just a microchip. So there are GPS devices. They're generally about the size of a golf ball and can go on a collar, but until you're able to plug your cat or dog into an app, split and charge it overnight, you're not going to have an implantable GPS device for a pet. So a microchip is about the size of a piece of rice, and you see a picture there. If you can see the presentation, ours actually, because of the polymer, looks like a piece of rice. So it's again a polymer, not glass. But a microchip is just it's a dormant or inactive object until it's activated by a microchip scanner. So it's the scanner that actually wakes up the chip, makes it transmit that unique microchip number, so it's read on the scanner. But if a microchip scanner is not around, that microchip is just a dormant, inanimate object located, again, in that sublayer, subcutaneous tissue of a pet.
Put him on the screen.
And I got another picture here that just kind of shows that's what our chip looks like, and you can see in comparison to a penny,
right?
Just how tiny it is.
Wow.
So a very small item.
Right. No, I was just asking Rock if he could put you on the screen instead of me, because I get tired of looking at me, and I'm sure quite a lot of other people do. But you up in the corner. Yeah. So, okay. So that was the technical thing. So that's pretty small for a chip. I mean, it's the size of a piece of rice. Man, how do you guys, that's technology.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah, that's a piece of technology. I mean, my eyes are bad as they are, but trying to get those electronics into a piece of rice would be quite interesting, I'm sure. So, okay. Smaller, weighs less than, it doesn't weigh much of anything. Cool. Okay.
Yeah, so it, the polymer chip that we have is about half the weight of a normal microchip. So that's good, because a lighter weight chip is not going to have any kind of migration problem that we talked about earlier. So, but it's, again, registration is the key, as we talk about for quite a while now, that people need to know whether a chip is registered. If you're not sure if your pet has a chip, just ask your veterinarian or take it to your local shelter and ask them to scan it. And again, the pet should be scanned every time it visits the office. So, and Foster, we keep talking about cats and dogs, but actually we have just about any kind of animal you could think of registered with PetLink, from parrots to monkeys.
And do people do cows, or they just go for branding cows? Steve? Oh, that's Steve's picture. Isn't that a cutie? Yeah, I don't know if you guys see that, but Steve, we just lost the link with Steve, and we're getting him back up in here.
Foster, I've had people contact our rescue group, because we're in Kentucky. We have a lot of horses, and some of these thoroughbred horses have to be registered before they can do, or have to be microchipped before they can go into the shows and all that. We've actually been asked to microchip horses so they can go into these shows and these events that, otherwise couldn't go into. So we've got Gabby, our rep. Again, I have to plug her, because she has helped me learn how to microchip horses, And it's totally different than microchipping a dog. I mean, a dog's done between the shoulder blade. A horse has to be done in the side of the neck and deep tissue and everything else. I mean, she actually helped walk us through and find the information we needed so we could microchip a horse to the horse standards, so that the horse could make the event. So
right.
They microchip just about everything out there. I mean, we've had people to ask us to microchip a lot of different things. So.
That's quite interesting. And for anyone trying to reach me on Facebook or whatever, I just have to tell you I've lost my connection. So I don't know what the hell is going on here. So don't blame me. I'll have to try that on my phone. Since we're trying to get Steve back, you have some more dogs you want to do, Paula?
I can. I would love to.
All right, but let's do some dogs, and maybe we'll get Steve's connection back in the meantime. because we can't save enough dogs.
Okay.
Good.
Okay. All right.
Rock, are you ready?
I'm always ready.
All right, let's go.
Okay. I just want to say something here. Ooh, that always starts out bad, doesn't it? These next set of dogs are from Moody, Alabama. And this lady is actually my vet. She took care of Ellie and did her heartworm treatment. Dr. Nelson is absolutely fantastic. I love her to pieces. So here we go. The first one is Daryl. Daryl is a big, handsome hound looking for his forever home. He is your typical lazy front porch dog, nose always to the ground. His hobbies include fetching, barking, and sleeping. Go figure. Ear rubs are Daryl's sweet spot. Give him one, and he will be your best friend forever. Now we have Booger. Booger says, kennel life stinks, adopt me. Booger is a one-year-old male boxer lab mix. He is high energy boy and needs someone to love him. He has been at the rescue for several months now, and he would love nothing more than a family of his own. Booger is great with other dogs, so that's a benefit. Now we have our young, beautiful Rosie. She's single. She loves men. She has just finished her obedience training at We Talk Dog, and she had been working on her social skills. If you are interested in this good-looking girl, just make an appointment to meet her, and I am sure you will fall in love. Now, next up, we have River and Mally. And they were found at the mall. They were dumped. These sweet girls are doing great. They are at We Talk Dog in Irondale being socialized and learning how to live the good life. They are developing awesome personalities and are getting along great with other dogs. If you are interested in either of them, just contact Roddy's and Noddy's, and they will answer any questions you have about these cuties. Now we have Baby Girl. Baby Girl is a seven-month-old Roddy. She is great with other dogs and will play until her little heart gives out. She would do best in an active home. She likes long walks, playing fetch, or just playing. She's a pup. So anyway, she's looking for her forever home, and she's really a sweetheart. Now, next up, we have a picture of two puppies. Mystique is the one with white on her chest, and Loki, white on the chin. Now, Mystique has been rescued. She has gone to her new home, and Loki is one of six puppies that was abandoned at the rescue on the front porch. They are about 2 months old, 3 months old now, and they would love to have someone help them learn about life. They're puppies, so they're going to be active, they're full of love, and they're puppies. Puppy breath and all. So anyway, if you can give Loki a home, I am sure that she would be your forever friend. And you can call the number that I'm going to give you and meet any of these dogs. It is Roddy's and Noddy's Incorporated, Dr. Rachel Nelson. That's in Moody, Alabama. The number is 205-640-4327. And that's the next to the last set of doggies today.
All right. So Now, I was just letting everybody know that I lost my internet connection on the computer, and I'm sure it's has something to do with, you know, the evil internet gods out there, the gremlins of the web, trying to get me. Did we get Steve back? Steve, you back?
Yes, I am.
Oh, okay.
Sorry about that, Foster.
Hey, that's all right. I've been hung up. I've been hung up by bigger names, brother.
I'm sure.
That's right. So no problem, man. So, you know, it was a question that somebody did send me. One second, on my cell phone from the. They were listening to this show. They said, do zoos use chips on their animals?
Some zoos do. Yes, absolutely.
Yeah.
It's a great way for them to, especially because they sometimes will send animals to other zoos for, you know, breeding and just sharing purposes. So they want to make sure they get the right animal back.
Right. Yeah, so, that right.
Yep.
That ain't my tiger. The tiger, the tiger we sent you guys had black stripes.
Yep. And I don't know if they lost the phone connection, but microchipping in equine or horses is gaining in popularity.
Really?
Shocking to find out that horse rustling or horse theft still happens quite a bit. And if people are competing in FEI horse events, microchipping is required. So again, they know that the horse that you entered or qualified for the event is the horse you're riding during the actual event.
Hmm.
So they require microchipping for that proof of identity. But I had a story from a client a few months ago that they had a horse breeder that shipped a horse from California to New York. Gentleman had bought the horse from online, sight unseen. And when the horse got to New York, of course, they tried to ride it and have it do the things that it supposedly was trained to do. And the buyer called the seller and said, "This horse is not what you promised." And they went back and forth for about a week on the phone. And finally, the guy from California flew to New York. And lo and behold, the horse that was there was not the horse he sold. So somewhere along the route, the horse got switched, looked identical. But unfortunately, that horse wasn't microchipped. But they could tell enough that the horse was not the same.
So, right. Wow. Wow.
And we have about anything you could think of registered in PetLink, from boas to lizards to monkeys, llamas and alpacas. Like I said, just about anything you can think of is, in fact, I just got an email from a vet in New York yesterday that New York Department of Agriculture has made microchipping of llamas and alpacas mandatory. San Antonio, Texas made microchipping mandatory for all pets in the city of San Antonio just recently. So it's gaining in popularity, and people are seeing the benefits of it. And some cities are looking at using the microchip number as actually the pet license number. Because again, it's unique and is never going to be changed. So that's happening in some communities around the country. And of course, I know a large topic of your show obviously is pit bulls, and people should know about the breed-specific laws in the different states.
Right.
There's a website called there's a website called dogbite.org, and on there they list all the states and all the different
we hate them.
Laws about that.
Yeah.
Do you? Okay, I don't know.
Yeah,
it's,
because the lady is insane, you know.
Is
but
she?
Yeah, she is.
That's a whole nother story and a whole nother show.
We have those people too that put up websites about microchipping that just carry all kinds of false information and rumor.
Yeah,
scary.
Yeah, the one thing about this show, Steve, is. We've got low friends in high places, you know, and vice versa, you know. We get the bottom line. I don't know why people think that I'm so. I don't hold nothing back, but I don't know where they get that. They could possibly come up with that, but you know, our phone rings. You know, we get the informants. If it's going on out there, and we find out what the truth is, and we you know, because we want everybody to be informed as much as possible and about the truth. You know, and as we say, we follow the money and different stuff. So, yeah, when it's people who are just in it for the sensationalism and just in it to because they don't have a life, so they don't mind telling lies and putting out information, and they're jealous of what other people are doing and stuff. They tend to just make up stuff, you know. So it's kind of that organization really has done way more damage than it has any kind of good, you know. And it's just, you know, that's the thing with the internet. Anybody with a mouse can, you know, claim anything, and you know, you get a domain, and that's a great little, that's a great name. And you know, a lot of publications, when you know how the news is, the reason that pit bulls have gotten part of the reputation that they have is, you know, if it bleeds, it leads with the news. And today in Los Angeles, there may be, you know, 150 dog bites, you know, but you, which will be poodles and German shepherds and chihuahuas and Irish setters and all kinds of stuff. But if there's one pit bull bite, you can guarantee that baby will make the news, you know? So, So these organizations, these news outlets, they use that lady and that whole organization is a hype thing, you know, to keep the public afraid and living in fear and lied to. So, but yeah. Anyway.
That's one of the unfortunate things about the internet. And I used to actually be in broadcasting and a journalist at local TV stations. But I recommend anybody use what a good journalist would use and, you know, double check and use, get three sources.
That's right.
Find three sources that, you know, confirm or concur, then you got good information.
That's right. You know, now I want to throw something out to you that you may want to put your team of developers onto. I was watching Sunday Morning this past week, and they had a story about the bees. You know, yes. It's major bee rustling going on now. You know,
Actually, beehive owners are microchipping their beehives.
Their beehives, you know, so.
Yep, they'll put a microchip into the wood in the frame of the beehive.
Right.
And obviously, typical person coming to steal. I saw the same story. Yeah, steal a beehive is probably not going to have a microchip scanner and check to make sure it's scanned.
Exactly.
Or dig that chip out.
But yeah.
Microchips are being used to help track down stolen beehives and get them back.
Yeah, put them up in the hive, and because they were saying that, you know, you can change the box. You know, once they change the outside crate that the bees are in, then they're just bees, you know. But the actual hives, the way that they have to pull the hives out and put them in, because that's where the queen is up in there somewhere. So I imagine you put the chip in there and it's good to go, right?
Yep.
Yeah, that's that. Yeah, it's so interesting, man. You know, it's like only part of it's this whole business that you're in is deals with lost and found. A lot of it is theft and recovery, huh?
Oh, absolutely. And we were talking about equine a little bit earlier. So people have actually started also microchipping those expensive saddles. Because, again, tough to identify that, but you implant a microchip hidden inside the saddle. It's a pretty sure way of knowing where that saddle came from.
Right. Now, I wanted to ask you, and again, there goes that 63 kicking in, because as I had that thought, I lost it. Damn it, Richard. You know,
it's like, it's not my fault. I didn't make you drink that drink last night.
I would remember if I had been drinking. It's that cleaning up your act is killing me, man. You know? It'll come back to me in a few. But so continue on where we left off. I don't know where we left off on the presentation or something. Do you?
There's always a good information to talk about. So one of the things we were talking about, you know, registering, people can register any chip at PETLINK. But it's always good to also make sure that a chip from a specific manufacturer is registered with that manufacturer. So again, because if a chip comes up with a 9 982 number instead of 981, they may not look at the AHA website that, again, looks at multiple databases. They may only go to that one supplier. And if that chip's not registered with that supplier, they're going to think it's not registered anywhere. So we recommend people try and have their chip registered with the company it came from. But you can also register at multiple places to make sure you have the best chance of your information being found if that pet ever does show up at a shelter as a lost or found pet.
Right. Now, tell me this. I know what it was. Is a GPS chip on you guys' future radar or what? How do you feel about that?
So the problem with having a GPS in a device that's smaller than a piece of rice is a GPS device takes a battery.
Oh, okay.
And so far, there's not the technology to have an item, you know, be able to be recharged inside the body of a pet. Mm-hmm. And because when a GPS device is constantly transmitting, right, and connecting to cell towers or to satellites, so to transmit or be an active device, it takes a battery or some kind of power source. Right. Whereas a microchip, like we mentioned earlier, is just a dormant or inactive object until a microchip scanner activates it. Mm. And then it transmits the number just for a brief second.
Mm-hmm. That makes a lot of sense, you know. Hadn't even thought about that. You know, you got to charge the battery in a GPS device.
Yep. So until we can come up with a way to plug your cat or dog into the wall outlet, you're going to have to rely on an external GPS device.
Yeah, you have to put a solar chip. You know? So he hits the sun on the skin and all that kind of stuff. But you wait, you know. I mean, we may not see it right now. But probably 20 years from now, somebody will have that, probably in your company, one of your developers, you know?
Yeah. Yep. So we've got engineers always looking at what's next. Again, so we invented the polymer to be a better, safer chip, and
yeah.
We're not sure where we go from there.
Yeah.
Hey, one thing I do want to mention too, Foster, about about the different types of chips,
mm-hmm.
is there's some companies now that are introducing what they call a mini chip, or a small, shorter chip. And we, again, as a manufacturer, look at all kinds of things to decide what our next chip is going to look like and properties it's going to have. So we maintained the length of the chip for the most part, because the length of the chip can affect the read distance. And these small, tiny chips that are short do not have a very good read distance, and Richard may be able to talk about this as well. I can put you in touch with a number of shelter directors that would like to throttle the neck of some of these companies selling these mini chips because they're so hard to find, especially on a large animal with heavy fur or thick skin. They have, if they know the chip is there, they have to scan three times as long to find the chip and then obviously find the pet owner information. So be careful again about what chip company you're using. Do your due diligence and research and look for a chip company that's been around for a long time and has a good reputation.
Yeah, that's kind of like, well, we don't care once we get it out the door, huh?
Yeah, right, in some cases. So thankfully, you know, most veterinarians are obviously very caring people and want the best medicine for their pets and their pet owners.
Cool. Hey, I think somebody's calling that has a question for you. Hello?
Yes, good morning.
Good morning. Who's this?
My name is Susan Taney, and I'm the director of Lost Dogs Illinois.
Oh, really?
We're actually a nonprofit organization that helps people find their lost dogs in Illinois. We've reunited over 15,000 dogs in the last 4.5 years.
Well, Jesus.
Wow, congratulations.
Well, you know, it's your lucky day. You just happen to call on a day when we have someone that you would like to talk to.
I certainly do. And the question that I want to ask is that we do a lot of events, and we do free scanning events. And, you know, we scan everyone's dogs for free, and we are just absolutely surprised. How many people really don't know that much about microchips?
Yeah, you're right. You're totally right.
It's amazing.
It is amazing.
They don't even know what chip they have. They don't know if the dog's registered to them. They don't know if the right dog is registered. You know, and I guess our feeling is that this falls back to the rescues, the shelters, and the vet offices.
That's correct.
Because they should be doing a better job explaining how this microchip works. Or do you have any other suggestions?
Well, before Steve answers that question, you know, me, again, I'm you remember the show Hogan's Heroes? You
know, yeah. Absolutely. One of my favorites.
Right. What was the sergeant?
Schultz.
I know nothing. Okay. So I want to preface anything you hear on this show coming out of my mouth with that. You know, but personally, I just believe that, you know, it comes down to not even the vet and the chip companies, the rescues, or the shelters, because I personally feel like everybody's got their hands full, you know, and they're doing the best they can. But I think it is, one, personal responsibility, two, you know, I mean, because we're getting in political season, you know, Republicans and Democrats, and everybody's always crying about the government. But I think it is the municipalities. It is the cities. It is the states. It is the federal government. I think it has to be an education on a broader scale. You know, certain things have to become part of pop culture. You know, the new dances, the kids find out about the new dances like that. You know, people find out about the new coffee like that. You know, they find out about the latest feature in a car like that. It's the same thing, you know. It has to become part of pop culture. Somebody has to care enough. Because, again, it's just like the homeless situation. It's just like the overbreeding and these in the dog populations. Personally, I think it's too many people making money off of dogs being euthanized in the shelters, you know. So that's just my personal opinion of why people don't know about chips and people don't advocate for getting chips in dogs, you know, because let's be honest, Steve wants every dog in America to have a chip. He's making money. He's got a monetary gain, you know, to make. So he's an advocate for it. So it's not his fault. And the veterinarians, you know, if they could chip for $20 a piece, if they could chip 4,000 dogs a day, they'd be chipping them. You know, it's not their fault, you know. And the rescues, the people that I know in rescue, they're trying best to move dogs into homes. And, you know, Paula's just bringing on, 20 dogs a day here on this show trying to get them adopted. So I personally think that it's the kind of thing that we have to push to our political, you know, people to get behind on the education of the public.
You're right, Foster and Susan. I don't know if you heard me earlier, but there is a lot of education.
Wait a minute, you guys. Richard, let the guest talk first, I think.
Okay.
Yeah, I'll be quick, Richard. Sorry. So, like I mentioned earlier, we are out in veterinary offices and at trade shows all the time trying to promote the scanning of every pet. Again, it is the Veterinary Medical Association kind of policy, but not enough vets are aware of it. But when we talk about it, they actually see the value and agree. And we've had quite a few in the past year or so start to adopt that policy, which will help educate people more. And it's amazing the clinics that adopt that policy will scan a pet, and the pet owner didn't know it had a chip. They got it from a friend or adopted it out and didn't know it had a chip, or had forgotten about the chip. And again, they've moved two or three times right. Since they last made the registration. So it's a good chance for them to be reminded to update that registration. So, there's a lot of education that needs to be done. So.
Yeah. Well, let me ask this. And Richard, hold on to your thought, too. I want you to say something. But what about a situation like that? And ma'am, that I'm sorry, I missed your name.
Susan.
And I'll forget it too, so don't worry. What happens when, let's say I adopt a dog from a shelter, right? And I bring it to one of your events, and there's a chip in this dog, and it's from some old owner or whatever. Can these chips, one, be removed, and can you replace the information that's on the chip? What's the process on that, Steve? And Susan.
Are you asking me or asking?
Both of you.
Well, what we do at free scanning events is we actually have, you know, we actually use our representative, Debbie Collins, we use the PETLINK scanner, and we actually scan them. We have the list of all our sheet with all the different microchip companies, and we actually have a sheet of paper that goes out, manage your microchip. We give them all the steps, but we give them the 1-800 number and the microchip, and we ask them to call the company, find out if their dog's registered to them, you know, blah, 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 blah. And then if they have, we also say, you know, let's say someone's taken their friend's dog. We always tell them to make sure they have a transfer of ownership, because I think I'm right on this, that the chip companies want to have some kind of proof saying that the dog now is someone else's dog. But I know that we got so many different chip companies, so I don't know what PetLink does. What do you
think? Yeah, you're absolutely right, Susan. We require a transfer of ownership or proof of ownership, so something from the vet or something from the previous owner, and we have that information on PetLink.net. Of what it takes to transfer ownership of a microchip of a pet.
Right.
Yeah.
So, and we can get involved in some messy legal battles sometimes, divorces and whatever.
When they enter a shelter or ACO facility, they have to be scanned, and within 24 hours of intake, and then they're scanned before they're adopted, transferred, or euthanized. Hmm. And also when they're adopted out, they are microchipped too.
Okay, yeah, because I could see that being a problem, especially when someone finds out that, you know, that their dog has a chip. And, you know, I could see how that could be a major, major conflict. I mean, it's a good thing and it's a bad thing because, one, if the dog has a chip and it was the dog, I mean, I could get ugly. Like, now, Steve, you were saying that you guys been involved in some lawsuits and different stuff, but I mean, has it been cases where someone like Susan would scan a dog and find that was scheduled to be euthanized or whatever, or and someone has adopted this dog, and then all of a sudden the scan turns up that, you know, Fluffy has been missing from Idaho for 3 years?
Well, yeah, there was an article, I forget where I saw it not just this past week, where a woman had a puppy she adopted, and the puppy got lost. And after, I think it's about a span of 4 years, and she had the pet microchipped and had that registered. And then about 4 years later, just recently, this pet showed up, I guess, scanned, and they found out her original information. But that pet had gone through two other owners since then. The problem is, she, you know, registered with a company that, you know, doesn't have the best reputation and really didn't do its job. So when someone tried to look up the registration or chip information, they didn't find it.
Let's name them.
Yeah. Don't want to go there. But the more surprising thing is the local DA made a ruling in the case and said the pet belonged to the most recent pet owner and didn't give it back to the original young lady. And I found that surprising. But
that's very surprising. I mean, that's amazing. Could we look that case up somewhere, man? Because that's the kind of stuff we like to have on the show, because that's criminal. That's like saying that, you know, your first kid is not your first kid. If somebody kidnapped it and they, you know, they sold it to somebody else, you know? Wow.
That was in Minnesota where that happened.
I think you're right. Just
That's incredible. Richard, you were going to say something before I cut you off, like I always do.
Yeah, I'm used to it now, Foster, but that's all right. Well, I was just going to say that, you know, as a rescue, one of the things that we do, because a lady from Illinois, from Los Angeles, Illinois, brought up that she'd like to see more and more, you know, vets and stuff doing things to help educate people so people would register their chips. What we found the easiest thing to do, because when we buy the chip from PetLink, that chip now belongs to us. So when we use that chip, we automatically go in and register that dog and that chip, mm-hmm. the minute that dog is chipped. Even if somebody comes to one of our microchip clinics and gets their dog that never belonged to us chipped, we still, as a rescue group, we register that chip with the information we have in a questionnaire that you fill out. You know, how long have you had this dog? Where did you acquire the dog?
Right.
You know, what distinguishing marks, name, blah, 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 a whole bunch of stuff. We go in with PetLink because there are chips. We register those chips so we know that that dog has at least been registered through us to that owner. Now, right. PetLink sends them an email that tells them, you know, hey, Unchained Love has released this microchip to you. Here's what you need to do. Now, if they don't follow up, we can't be faulted for that. But what we've done is their information's already there. So if that dog is lost, they're going to know that that dog belongs to this family. They're going to contact them first because we've already done our part. We registered their phone number, their address, their email, everything.
So
now, if they don't accept that chip transfer, then it still comes back to us. We're still going to get the information, and then we have that on file in our computer database.
Right.
And we contact the people and say, hey, look, your dog's been found. You know, are you capable of picking it up? If not, we're going to go pick up your animal for you.
Right. That's, you know, so that, yeah, that's interesting. So basically, in with that particular scenario, if this other this dog that we're talking about in Ohio, Susan and Steve, if it had been a permalink chip with like Richard's Unchained Love on it, it wouldn't have never gotten to the third owner before it had been scanned and somebody would have contacted Richard. And then inevitably, that's too big a word for me, at some point, they would have Richard would have been able to stand up and say, this first owner was the owner original, the owner of the dog. Correct?
Yeah, absolutely. Uh-huh. Absolutely.
Yeah.
So well, Richard mentioned earlier the guardianship feature, and we're proud to offer that to the rescues and shelters that use us in that, you know, they like to keep in touch and keep tabs of what's going on with their pets. So if a pet shows up at a shelter, you know, three or four times, they may want to check in the situation and see why that's happening so much.
Mm-hmm.
So.
But the thing is, not all the chips do that. I mean, there's only a few that,
correct.
I mean, with free registration. But I just want to tell you something. I just got a reunited on our Facebook page, and this dog is reunited after 35 days. We always ask, describe how the dog was found. It appears that the microchip was located in the hip of the dog instead of the neck. When the vet checked, they only checked for the neck. Once the hip area was scanned, we were able to locate the owner. I mean, about the chip migration, still, you know, are all vets, all rescues, all shelters doing proper AVMA scanning procedures?
Yeah, we try and go and educate about proper scanning procedures and have a video online, too. So the other thing, Foster, we're a manufacturer, so when we realize that most microchip scanners have scanned a very small area of the pet, so very specific. This is, I don't know if you can see it here, this is one of our other scanners that we just released recently. So a microchip scanner typically has an antenna at the top of the scanner. And so when someone is scanning a pet, it's very specific. This scanner and our other one here, we said, let's get innovative and widen the scanning area, so we're going to find those chips that happen to have maybe migrated. So this scanner has the antenna around the entire outside edge.
Wow.
And so the person doing the scanning doesn't have to get right on top or be as specific. So if that person scanning that pet where the chip relocated to the hip had been using one of our new scanners, they would have found that chip much, much easier and not missed it.
Wow,
so,
that's a huge scanner there. Now, that, I mean, that's is that for the veterinarians? Well, are they all for veterinarians, huh?
They're all for veterinarians. I mean, this one's used in all kinds of situations. I mean, this one's large to give us that large scanning area.
Yeah.
And this one actually is pretty unique. I'm going to guess again, you probably can't see the menu here.
No, not when it goes
but,
wide.
Yeah, so this... this scanner actually has built-in memory. It uses a USB connection, so people can connect it to a computer and transmit the microchip numbers into their pet record or for registration. Because that's one of the other things that happens is a microchip number, again, is a 15-digit number in most cases for an international chip. People registering their chips type out that 15-digit number. Too many times they'll transpose a number or get a number wrong. I mean, if I had to type in a 15-digit number, I'd probably get 12 of them wrong.
Mm-hmm.
So they're misregistering that chip, and we'll learn about those misregistrations eventually and get them corrected. But by using a scanner that can transmit that number automatically, we're going to eliminate those typos and those misregistrations.
Mm-hmm.
So we're always, as a company that, again, focuses and works entirely in radio frequency ID technology, trying to find a way to make Susan's and Richard's and Abby's jobs easier and those animal control officers' jobs easier and more foolproof. So having a scanner that will find a chip in a at a greater distance and faster and can record the chip numbers, people in the animal health industry are in Susan and Richard's kind of positions are loving the scanners. So
where are you guys located at?
So our U.S. offices are located just outside Boston in a community called Woburn. And this is where we actually work in three different radio frequency ID fields. We do companion animal, obviously. We actually do textile microchipping. And we have a division out in Temple, Texas that deals with livestock. And I know before I came on, you were asking about if cows are chipped.
Yeah.
Cows and cattle and dairy industry use ear tags typically because you don't want to implant a device into an animal that's going to end up in the food chain.
They'll use
the external tags.
That makes a lot of sense.
Yeah.
I hate it when that rib has microchip in it.
Microchip in it? Yeah.
All right, so
a little extra crunch.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. It's like, mommy, get through that phone. You know, it's an alien. Okay, so I think we left off on this chip education show that we're doing with the promo code of Foster's Animal World, where lifetime registration with your chip and your animal for your microchip is $9.99, which is like at least $10 off the cost.
That's right? Exactly right. $10 off the cost for the lifetime registration with free updates and stuff for the life of the pet. So that's at petlink.net. Yes. And again, when they go to the checkout page, they just put in FAW, and they'll get that reduction in the registration cost.
Yeah, Brock.
Hey, Steve, I have a question.
Wait, one second, Richard. Brock has something he wanted to ask. Go.
Steve, I have something to say. Since the cows have ear tags, now all you have to do as a company is take that ear tag and implant the chip into the tag with the matching numbers on the tag, and now you can now sell ear tags to cows, people who have cattle.
We do, actually, so that does exist.
Okay, so
it's a great idea.
Yeah, see?
We got another one over there. Okay, we got some callers coming in here. Richard, what were you going to say in the meantime?
Well, I was just going to ask Steve, like when we buy our chips, ours already come with the lifetime. You're just talking about that $9.95 for people who have maybe a home again chip or one of the 900 ISO chips or something like that. You're talking about those chips, right, for the discounted lifetime registration?
Correct.
Okay.
So yep. People want to take advantage of the lifetime registration at a low cost and not have to get those renewal emails from some of those other companies and pay annual fees.
So what you're saying, and correct me if I'm wrong, is that if you got a, you're saying if they got a chip with another company, they can register with you?
Correct.
Oh, hey, so guys, get that. We'll repeat that, and you guys play it back so you understand. But, you know, and if there's any questions about that, there's somebody at the 877-738-5465 number that they can always call, right, and say, hey, tell me about this discount with Foster's Animal World.
Sure.
Okay, cool. So who do we have on the line, Rock?
Person has a question.
Okay. Person, who is this? Hello, somebody on the phone? Hello. Did we lose you? Are you there? Hello? Uh-oh, it's another one of those mystery callers.
Hold on.
Rock's getting them back. Okay, hello?
Yeah, hi, I'm here.
Hi, who's this?
This is Cecilia Maida from Northern California.
Cecilia Maida, hey, how are you, dear?
I'm good, how are you?
Oh, I'm great. Okay, so Cecilia is not necessarily a question about the chip, I don't think, Steve.
No, actually I am. I'm calling in about a question on the chip. I just came in on the show last minute here, and I wanted to make sure I called on this
Oh, okay. All right. Because Cecilia, just so you know, Steve, Cecilia is one of our correspondents from Northern California. She does a little segment on what's going on the street, sort of like a word on the street, you know, because as awesome as I am and as, you know, as hard as Paula tries, we can't keep up with everything, you know? So we have our little spies out around the country. You know, Richard's pretty good, you know, he's on the road too much, you know? So Cecilia helps us out with, you know, news around it. But go ahead with your question, Cecilia.
Yeah, hi. I apologize. I don't know the gentleman's name that is
Steve.
Your guest today.
Steve.
Hi, Steve.
Hey, Shelly.
I was calling. I was actually excited to see that they were talking about chips because I deal with a lot of animal abuse and everything. And I one thing that we notice is that when they go into the shelters, a lot of times people aren't chipping them, et cetera. And so one thing I wanted to find out, are there any mandates that, like, require shelters to check the chip?
There aren't really any mandates. I mean, most shelters do. As Susan kind of mentioned earlier, that it's a typical shelter protocol. Richard may comment about this, too, that a pet be scanned when it's picked up, scanned again when it's brought into the shelter facility check-in. A lot of animal control officers actually have microchip scanners in their cars or trucks, so they'll scan that pet typically when they pick it up. Because most of the goal of most animal control officers and shelters is to get that pet back home as soon as possible. And if they can scan the pet and look up the microchip information out in the field and see that that pet owner lives around the corner, they would rather obviously take that pet directly home rather than take it back to the shelter. So, you know, we supply scanners to animal control officers out in the field quite a bit. So,
yeah,
but most shelters do scan and most shelters do chipping. There are some states where it's mandatory. I believe it's Oklahoma now mandates that every animal being adopted out through their shelters be chipped. And there's other states that do that as well. But it's a state by state or community by community thing.
Okay, I'd be interested maybe at a later time to learn that from you, not to take up the airtime on the show. Because we have a situation like in Austin Animal Control right now. There was an animal that was abused and abandoned, and a rescue group ended up taking it in for a couple of years trying to help the animal. And then it got out one day and ended up picked up by Animal Control, but the chip had never been maybe found, updated, and still had the abusive owners, and it got returned to them. So do you have any suggestions on how to remedy that type of situation?
Sure. If the shelter had looked up the chip, I don't know if they did and didn't find the registration or what happened in that case. But in that scenario, if it was a PetLink chip, the animal control officer or agency would typically contact us, explain the situation, and we would, you know, change the registration in that case. So again, we would require court documentation and things from them, but we certainly would have helped them modify that registration and have it available to as a clean microchip for the new owner once that pet got adopted.
Okay, and one thing I noticed, the biggest thing, like the woman from Illinois with the lost pets, is a lot of people aren't aware about the chips. A lot of people are given a dog. They don't even think about a chip till the dog disappears and they find it in a shelter and then they can't prove it's theirs, et cetera. So they're very, very, very valuable in reuniting owners. But I'd be interested later at another time to be able to chat with you because I'm all about educating the public. I'm kind of the animal abuse media lady, but I kind of tie into, I try and get the word out on anything, so I'd be happy to help you get out there and spread the word on these microchips so that we can reunite more animals with their owners. That was
sure.
Answer my question.
You can get my contact information from Paula. No problem. Give me an email or call anytime. So, you know, you're right about, you know, one of the things we do as a company, we're the only company that provides actually the pet owner that has our chips, a wallet card where we put the barcode number on the wallet card. So every microchip will come with a series of barcodes. And typically what will happen is the shelter or technician in the vet clinic will put one of these barcodes on the pet record, the paper record that's in their closets. And then we ask them to put one on the wallet card. So the pet owner always has the proof and the specific, like, a lot of the company will provide a paper handwritten form. Hmm. And if you handwrite the number too many times, you make a mistake and transpose the number or forget one.
Right.
And if you don't have the accurate number, you're not going to find that registration.
Right. It is gone.
Great. And one final question is, when, for instance, like when an animal is adopted, they've followed the proper procedure, they've chipped, scanned it in the shelter, the owners don't want it back, the animal's been rescued, they chained it to the rescuer, now they take it into foster, then they home it, and then they bring it up to Canada, and then, they take it in from Canada or wherever. We don't. The question is, I guess, is that, is there any way to continually track an animal? Like, for instance, one just got rescued in Southern California, but they go, oh, it's in a foster in Colorado, but, oh, it's going to Canada. But we never really feel confident where we know where a dog landed in the end after it was rescued. Do you have any way, any suggestions on that avenue so that we know an animal arrived safely at a destination? As far as, because we're having an epidemic of we've got bad rescuers, we've got bad fosters, we've got bad transports. We've got criminals crawling all over the threads because they're smelling the cash on these animals. And sometimes they actually, it's horrible to say, but I see it all the time because they nicknamed me the animal abuse media lady. But they actually rescue them specifically because they're injured and they have a lot of money on the thread, $3,000. Then they take them and go shoot them, And now they find them in, like, carriers on the side of the road in bushes in Long Island in the snow and anything. But do you have any suggestions on how we can utilize your device? I know that I heard you can't use a GPS because it needs a battery. But anything, like maybe even federal legislation where you could get involved, to where anytime anybody rescues, that they're under mandate or something, because we've got to stop this epidemic of dogs just, being killed after they're rescued, after they collect all the money and the pledges. Criminals are starting to see this as easy money.
Well, that's
the dark side.
So horrible. The only thing, as far as tracking, again, it's not a GPS device, but Richard talked about earlier the guarding feature that we offer. So we're one of the few companies that anytime, so if a rescue uses our microchips and registers in PetLink, anytime that pet has a found or lost pet report filed, that agency gets identified or gets notified. That way they kind of keep up with, again, what's happening with the pets that they've given out to different pet owners or had adopted out or rescued. And if they see a pattern of something, they can get involved. Too many times that our parent organization isn't notified about what's happening with the pets that they put out with pet owners. But the guardian feature with PetLink allows them to kind of be that overall controlling agency. So
okay.
And the pet owner can never remove that information.
Yep. So
where the animals are going, that's a very, very effective tool, it sounds like. So I will find out more information and spread the word because until we have like a national database and we have a way of doing this, that's uniform across the country so that we can keep track of these animals where they land.
That's right.
But you need to do me a favor. Could you just invent the GPS a little bit?
Hey, wait a minute. Cecilia, chill. Wait a minute. I'm working on that. This show needs some money. We need to be able to stay on the air. So I'm coming up with these these solar dog hairs that's going to power, the GPS for the chip. So we'll work on that later. Cecilia, let me get back to you a little bit later because I want to do your segment about, what's going on.
Yeah, I had to get in on this question, though.
This is perfectly fine, dear. I'm just saying that I want to do that because I've had Steve time on for a while, and this has been really, really great, but I want him to get out all of the information that he's trying to get out now, and because I got some other stuff, because I want to come back on this Mayor Garcetti thing and everything. So, Steve, what do you think? We'll be wrapping you up in about a half hour, or what do we need?
Yeah, that's fine. I'm here as long as you got questions or people, want information.
Okay, going. Well, we're here for it. We got another hour and a half, legally. And after that, they may come kicking the door in on us. So,
I can hang out for another 30 minutes and let you get back to the other things you want to cover.
Sure.
So that's fine.
Yeah. Well, I have no life, so it doesn't matter.
Me neither.
Yeah. Let's do this. Let's pick up on one. I think we were at we have passed that part. You tell me where we're at. I don't know.
Well, let me take a quick glance at Facebook, see if there's any more questions coming in there.
Oh, okay, yeah. Because we've been doing pretty good, I think.
Hey, Steve, I have a question for you right quick.
Sure.
You know, one of the things as a rescuer that I really appreciate with the tips that you guys offer is the fact that, you know, I don't know how much in the different areas it's happening, but in our area we're having people steal dogs because we live close enough to Nashville, St. Louis, Louisville, you know, the big cities, and they come steal our dogs because, unfortunately, in the small rural areas, we haven't educated enough, and that's our fault. The need for these chips. So they're coming down here, they're stealing our dogs, and they're taking them back to Nashville, St. Louis, Louisville, and they're flipping them. You know, they're stealing a $400 dog and going back to the area and flipping it for $200 or $300. But one thing we found that's helping us in our area is that they're stealing these little dogs, these little Yorkies and stuff, but then they're scanning them. When they get down the block, they get them in their vehicle, they go down the block, they scan them. Oh, wait, they got a chip. So here goes a little final toss out the door. Are you seeing that anywhere else? Because the dogs that are chipped seem to be, you know, just being lost. And it appears that they've just got wanted out of their yard. But they are actually being stolen, and they're being tossed out three or four blocks or a mile down the road. Is that happening anywhere else or just in our area? Because it seems to be happening a lot. Dogs that are chipped get thrown out. Dogs that are not keep going right to where they're going, you know, so they can dog flip them.
Yeah, Richard, that's horrible. That's the first I've heard of a situation like this. And, you know, obviously, I guess another testimony to why microchips work and why people should be microchipping pets. It's a permanent identification. No one can alter it. I mean, Foster, you asked a question earlier about can chips be removed. Certainly they can. It would be a surgical procedure, and, you know, we obviously don't recommend it. And again, a microchip should be good for the life of the pet. We've had, you know, people call us and say, look, I prefer your chip and I like the lower cost lifetime registration, but my pet already has a chip from another company. They want to insert a second chip into the pet. And we don't like to see a pet, you know, chipped twice or three times. I mean, I've heard stories of a pet being found that has four microchips or five microchips in it. And you don't want that because microchips could interfere with one another, but more commonly, when someone's scanning a pet and it's a microchip read, they're going to stop scanning that pet thinking they found the microchip you know, belongs to that pet, when there may be a second or a third there. And maybe it was the other chip that wasn't read that actually has the more current pet owner information. So you only want to microchip your pet once. Register that microchip again with the chip provider and maybe another company that is affiliated with the AHA search engine or has a good reputation in the industry.
Excuse me.
Yeah.
All right.
And Richard, have you, I'm just kind of curious, have you in your area, I know that's a pretty popular area with the pets and stuff and certainly a good area for us, do you see many of these 900 chips coming into your facilities?
I haven't seen the 900 chips yet. I mean, I've heard about them in Louisville. A few of my rescue friends there have been talking about them, and it's a nightmare for them. And I'm hoping that we don't get them. We do have a lot of people that want to use a lot of the cheaper chips, and we have a lot of vets that want to use the chip and want to charge you $14.95, $17.95 a year. And a lot of people are not paying that fee every year to keep their dogs. And then, of course, then the chip manufacturer is going, well, you know, then we're not going to update your information. So we are running into a lot of that. But as far as the 900 chips, thank goodness we haven't seen a lot of them yet. Now, that doesn't mean they won't be there because, I mean, from what I understand, these people are charging, you know, $2 or $3 for these cheap chips. And people are like, oh, well, I can save a few bucks. But they're not realizing that saving a few bucks in the end may cost your dog its life, you know. And
yeah,
I just, for me, I mean, we constantly go around and do events. You know, people come to us all the time and ask us why we choose PetLink. And I have a list of things. I just go down the whole list. You know, they're polymer instead of glass. They can't be broken as easily. You know, they have the great service behind them. They're a smaller chip, blah, blah, blah. Just go down the whole list of the gamut of things that what made us choose this company over all the other ones. And there are a lot out there. So, I mean, we did a lot of research. We spent about 6 months. Finally got to the very best of the best, we think. and we chose to stay with you guys. And we had people coming to us all the time. I want you to rechip my dog because I see all the benefits of your company. Well, we won't do that. You've got one chip. We recommend them to go to your website and then register their chip and pay the fee and then register that chip through you, and then they're done. It's great that you're offering a discount. I really appreciate that because we have a lot of people that go, well, I've already paid $40 for my chip. You know, I don't want to pay another $20, you know, to register. Well, you can either pay $20 one time and register with this company and get good service and stand behind it, or you can, you know, keep paying $19.95 or $17.95 a year with your service, with your company, and may or may not get the kind of service that we get. So it's your choice.
Yeah.
So
yeah, we like to make it simple for the pet owner, and felt that making it a one-time fee, they're more likely to keep that pet owner information current. So, as Abby mentioned earlier, we have a really good relationship with our pet owners. We don't hound them with solicitation. they get basically 4 emails from us a year, reminding them of their registration and making sure that their information is current. So again, because it's the registration that's key. People tell me all the time, or put it that a microchip is worthless without the registration, and that's so true. A microchip is an inanimate object, again, until activated by a scanner. But without the registration, we're not going to find that pet owner.
Right.
And, you know, the amazing thing about what you guys offer, and it's, you're the only company I know that offers this. I mean, there may be somebody else to come up along afterwards after we start using you. But that guardianship feature is what sold us to PetLink, because we now will always, if that pet gets moved and they're not supposed to in our rescue, be able to transfer the dog to somebody else. But if they do by chance break their contract, you know, we still have a way to keep up the animal. That guardianship is going to keep us in the loop no matter what. And there's no way around that. And I like that. I mean, it gives me peace of mind.
Yeah, that's great. Yeah, we're happy to offer it. And I think it would help the situation that Cecilia was talking about.
Mm-hmm. You had somebody on the phone, Rob? Huh? Eric? Oh, Karen. Oh, okay, about the mayor's thing. Okay, we can go. All right, so, hey, let's take a break and come back with Paula and do her dogs. One more set of dogs. And what else? And it was something else. I'll think of it during the break. We'll be right back.